tonight is one of my favorite topics, desire, which is our real wealth. The vast majority of people are born with many, many desires. So they continue to be poor throughout their life, often leading what to me is the saddest of life, superficial, content with little things, seeking little things, often concerning their personal appearance and personal possessions and little personal frivolities. These are the poorest people. And they hardly achieve any kind of success in any field. There are some who are born with some desires. And usually, these are the people who lead what are called successful lives. In whatever field it is, they don't have too many desires. They have some desires. And they manage to accomplish something at least, because they have only some desires. There are a fortunate few who are born with a few desires. Out of these come the genius, the great scientist, like Einstein, had very few desires. Great poets, great humanitarians, they have very few desires, and whatever field they throw themselves in, they'll make their mark. Scientist, statesman, musician, artist, poet, and last but not least comes a very, very rare few with only one desire. Out of those come the great mystics. And if you think more about this, you'll see meditation from another perspective altogether. Meditation is a difficult, demanding discipline for reducing the number of desires from many, many to many, from many to some, from some to a few, and from a few to one and one only. As the number of desires become less, there will be more depth to your life, more dimension. And I am one of those who think it is much better to suffer than to lead a superficial life, because suffering often can enable some people to grow. Whereas superficial life, you can never grow, you can hardly come to life. And I've been asked to talk about, to distinguish between devotion, passion, emotion. Those with many, many desires have emotion. They go up, they come down, they get upset. Not for a long time. That's one of the great advantages of being superficial. Because even your upsets will be superficial. just as your satisfaction will be superficial. The capacity to enjoy much goes with the capacity to suffer much. And those with a few desires have passion. Whatever field of life they throw themselves into, they will have a tremendous passion. And it is this passion which, driven by desire, makes for greatness. And in many walks of life, we can see this if you observe from this perspective. But devotion is the fusion of all passions. One's personal ambition, one's personal pursuit of pleasure, the need for prestige, and the preoccupation with profit, they all get welded together into one flaming passion which will sear the heart. That is why there can be a great deal of agony. And in the Gita, Sri Krishna will say, Bhaktya mam abhijanati. When you have this unified passion, you will know me in your heart. When you've transformed and transfused all your emotions, all your passions into one torrential river of devotion, Bhaktya mam abhijanati, that will lead you to the discovery of the self who is the Atman. My submission is that everybody has this capital. Because we are human beings, all of us have this capital, which is frittered away through our ignorance in a million fruitless, frustrating channels. And I'm going to comment on some of the important channels through which modern civilization wastes all its capital. See, our country, for example, should be the last one to be interested in money. It's a very different perspective that I'm giving. I can understand poor people being interested in money. I can understand impoverished people being interested in material possessions. But here we are in the most affluent country on the face of the earth. And I've seldom seen the madness for money, even to this extent, in the third world. Here is my hot item from today's paper. California lotto ticket buyers bet on everything from birthdays to football jersey numbers. Yesterday, in hopes of winning a record 57 million jackpot. As the jackpot in California's 649 lotto game climbed to a world record, veteran players and first-time buyers jammed into liquor stores, supermarkets, and convenience stores to take a chance on a few small white balls. Where is intelligence here? Where is discrimination here? Where is any kind of good sense here? The exact amount of the top prize for the next lotto drawing will not be decided until 7:45 p.m. today, 15 minutes before the big event. Just, you're getting it hot, you see. Just now it has been decided. That you can see the lust for money, into which so much of our desire, everybody's goes. California Lottery Information Officer Robert Taylor said the 57 million prize is already a world record. At 8 p.m., see the timing, 6 ping pong sized balls, each painted with a number between 1 and 49, will spill from an agitated container watched by agitated millions. The whole process takes only 90 seconds, but it seems like a lifetime for those who are hoping for a miracle to win. That's what all the desires have got. With a record 57 million in sight, Lotto Mania has reached impossible proportions. Office workers are spending their breaks betting on pools. Now, psychologists are offering an assortment of diagnoses for Lotto fever. Everybody makes money out of this, you see. And convenience stores are suddenly community centers. They become like churches, you see. Ticket selling became so frantic that at a 7-Eleven store in Truckee, the owner put an answering machine on his phone, wishing them luck and then hanging up. Phone from morning till evening, from evening till night. So, answering machine, wish you luck. Play Lotto, go Blotto. Of the 7,200 outlets in California, just imagine. This man's convenience store in the small Sierra Nevada town is the biggest retailer of lottery tickets. Now, I am not condemning or criticizing. I am just trying to show where all this capital wealth is going to waste. Everybody, professionals, medical people, engineers, carpenters, dentists, everybody, you see, has become affected. So that they don't know that's where all their capital is being exhausted. That is why Sri Ramakrishna says, don't love money. That's why the first decision that I made was that I will never charge anybody any fees for giving them this greatest of gifts, the gift of Dharma. And see, all that lust for money has gone into the river of devotion. Kabir hasna duri kari, kathir ravan sau chitta, bin roya kyupaya, prem piyara mita. O Kabir, leave aside all this flirting with, let me read, O Kabir, leave aside this flirtation and fill your heart with longing. Without tears of yearning, who can hope to see the face of the beloved? Kabir, hasna duri kari. Hasna, all this ridiculous stuff. Going and making more material things so that we have to work longer, so that we can buy more, then we can work more, we can buy more. He says, it's all ridiculous, hasana. And you've heard me saying how shopping centers have become temples, have become marble-floored cathedrals, where people worship with their desire. That is what worship means, worship with their cravings. And this is not at the expense of legitimate shopping. That there, I must tell you that I am all in favor of legitimate shopping. Now, he says, this is where people lose their capacity to love, their capacity to be passionate, their capacity to be devoted by giving a good deal of importance to buying and selling, accumulating and accumulating, until there is no place even to store them. Parbati, Parbati, my Pirya, Nain Gave Roy, so Bhuti Pau Nahi, Jate Jivani Hoy. In search of the herb that would make me immortal, I have roamed the mountains, I have wept with yearning, but I am still searching, still searching. As Meister Eckhart puts it, we are all looking for God. When we go to the supermarket, when we go to the shopping center, we are going to find something that will please us always. We want to buy something that will make us happy always. And that's very profound psychology. After wearing something a few times, you don't like to wear it. And I heard about expensive dresses for certain special occasions that can be only worn once. And see, all my clothes are nice. They are worn 100 times. That's what makes them comfortable for me. In fact, I got an old London fog that you all gave me when we moved in. I have to hide it in my trunk because Christine wants to give it away. See, I like that coat. It feels so nice. It has adjusted itself to my, to the outlines of my figure, and I got quite attached to it. So I just keep it on the pretext that one day I may need it for the beach. She always says to the girl, don't let him wear it in the city. It's a very different attitude towards clothes, you see. And we all know, I am always for wearing nice clothes. But to think that my security from those clothes, which is the basis of the clothes industry, is, Kabir says, ridiculous. Similarly, I go to the hair cutting lady every week. There isn't much for her to do. But I like to have a little attention paid to my mustache. And but when you start thinking that your hairstyle, if you change it, you change your personality. That your clothes style, you change your personality. Kabir says, don't be ridiculous. You change your personality when you change your thinking. In search of the herb that would make me immortal, I've roamed in the mountains, I've wept with yearning, but I'm still searching, still searching. These are all profound insights into human nature. I think it is Carl Jung. I have another quotation which I'll be using on Tuesday. from Carl Jung, who says, when he looks at all the older patients he has had, he says, they could all have been protected against most of their illnesses if they had had a sense of religion. And he says, it's not going to church. He's able to say that. It's not going to church or it's not going to a place of worship, but if they had a sense of religion, a sense of the divine, they would have been protected against all these illnesses. Gita, sulpam apyasya dharmasya trayate mahato bhayat. And to show you another way, entertaining way in which this has happened, can any of you tell me, who is acquainted with the video world, what is the latest, most demanded, most popular video? There you are. E.T. It's such widespread demand that the stores are not able to keep up with the demand. And it's not just in this country, in Europe, in many other countries in South America. There's a demand for millions and millions of copies of videos of E.T. The extraterritorial, the most popular movie of all time, even bigger than the Gone with the Wind, makes its debut on video cassettes on Thursday. This week is a very important week for us, you see. Thursday, 2 days ago, it made its debut. And Bay Area stores are getting ready to handle the million people who want them just from the Bay Area. When the film about a creature from outer space who befriends a suburban boy, Bob Farmer is the great authority. It is his great ambition to take me to see E.T. An ambition which I fear will not be fulfilled. About a creature from outer space who befriends a suburban boy, was put into theatrical release in 1982. The movie grossed $700 million, outstripping such all-time favorites as Gone with the Wind. Now, why I get baffled is, why not people demand 80, the Atman? Everybody should line up for 80, all over the world. And this is not a visitor from outer space. It's a visitor in inner space who can befriend you, your family, your children, your patients, your students. I say, go and get a E.T., but don't forget to get a A.T. also with it. This is the specialty of my approach. Yeah, E.T. all right, but E.T. without A.T., it'll be an encumbrance. And the reason is, nobody suspects, you know. Nobody has seen an extraterritorial creature so far. Nobody knows anything about any extraterritorial creature, but here is everybody believing, acting as if they believed. All therefore, I would say is, the Buddha has seen 80. Jesus the Christ has seen 80. He says, if you have seen the Son in 80, you have seen the Father 80 too. And why not? Francis has seen 80. Teresa has seen 80, so why not we believe them? When they say, we have seen 80. This is where all this interest curiosity goes into frustrating channels. And the main reason why I don't want to see 80 is because I've seen 80. After 80, what is 80? In search of the herb that would make me immortal, I have roamed in the mountains. I wept with yearning, but I'm still searching, still searching. The second statement of Carl Jung is that in the unconscious of everybody, there is fear of death. According to the Hindu and Buddhist sages, it is inescapable because we've been born so many times, suffered so many times, died so many times, and there's a lurking fear. It is not of the unknown, of the unremembered. And according to them, it is this desire to overcome terrible memory, which will slowly become activated as we move into our latter years, that is responsible for all this frantic pursuit of pleasure and profit, of power and prestige. It's a very compassionate explanation. And the explanation, for example, why I am not interested in money or anything like that is I've seen 80. I don't have that fear. And I hope to live a long, energetic, loving, wise life for many decades. But when the time comes, I know that's not the end. I know that all that will happen to me is it will happen to this blazer. It will fade away. I would need another new blazer. I'll have another new body to continue this work so that I don't have even any curiosity about death. Here, let me give you another fascinating example from the kingdom of what we call in Kerala, sea elephants, which are the whales. See, I'm deeply interested in elephants and I'm deeply interested in whales, so though I know little about them, and I've been following with great fascination the story of those two gray whales caught in those giant icebergs from which there was no escape at all. And this is why I say I am all in favor of science. And in my mother tongue, there's a saying, to make a memorable week, it makes three great events. So we got Lotto and, come on, pardon? E.T. And now, we got the whales. Two California gray whales, trapped in ice for 3 weeks, finally swam free yesterday. You know how much joy it has brought people. They're celebrating. Moving into open water in their long delayed migration out of the Arctic to warmer seas, rescue officials announced. In this love, all national barriers were forgotten, even between the superpowers. The breakthrough confirmed by airplane and helicopter reconnaissance flights. Climax Dam marathon rescue operation that combined the work of Eskimos making breathing holes, environmentalists, oil company experts, US military and civilian officials, and Soviet ice-breaking crews. What a wonderful example of love in action. Earlier in the day, the whales had moved to within 100 yards of open water, then disappeared. But reconnaissance flights later revealed whale tracks, a series of holes left behind in thin ice by the whales surfacing to breathe as they headed out of a clear white channel through the Chukchi Sea. The whales are really gone for sure, said North Slope Borough Mayor Jort Amogak. They had a will to live, Whale U.S. Rescue Coordinator Ron Morris said. A big celebration of the successful rescue attempt was planned in Barrow, the northernmost community of the United States, which has served as the base of operations to free the whales. Now, we are all like these whales. Caught and slowly being suffocated. And we can all make our little holes in the ice through a personal effort. And my submission is, if a lot of people make a lot of holes in the ice, there is no ice, everybody will find a sea. It is not that I don't appreciate the Soviet icebreakers, the Eskimo ice hole borers, but everyone has got to do this. And this is why we want to get students to turn to meditation on the Berkeley campus. We want people all over the country to be interested in learning to meditate, because it will finally enable them to find their way to the sea.